Romans 12. Now, just as an interesting point of thinking about perspectives and connecting and other stuff, we oftentimes are unable to get outside of our own reality. We're stuck inside of our day and our month. And one of the fun things that I like to do is anytime I'm at the high schools where they have the old pictures, is my mic, is the battery dead?
Oh, we lost you.
All right, that'd be a dead battery. It's a dead battery. It's flashing. I just spun the batteries so they. For those in the
supportive world.
That was not an issue that Peter and Paul dealt with. All right. I'm back on. All right, so I enjoy walking through high schools, especially ones that I know people that graduated from there, and they have the old yearbook pictures up on the wall, trying to find people, and seeing what they look like. Sometimes it's just amazing how little some people have changed, and sometimes it's amazing how I'm convinced it's a typo underneath a picture, and how it could not have been that person. If you were to go back into my school, you would see a bunch of hair and a little sliver of face with the name Ben Murray under it. I won't mention a current athlete's name, but I'm pretty sure he's just trying to look like me because he's doing exactly what I did. But it's funny just with the perspective of things and what they changed, because if you were to look at my dad in 1979, to 1983, you'd see someone who was the exact same size as me. This is one of my dad's, I believe, college suits that he gave to me whenever I first went off to seminary. I said, I don't have any suits, Dad. So he took out some of his old suits, gave them to me, and voila, we are the exact same size. Just this perspective, because if I were to think, what does my dad look like? Would I think he looks like this? Would I think like he looks like the man from 1997 who biked 3,000 miles a year? Or would I think he looks like Abraham Lincoln, which if you were to ask anyone in my class, hey, what does Ben's dad look like? They'd all say Abraham Lincoln, because that's how he had his beard for that time. But perspective on items and who we are, it's all linked to this idea of, are we able to get outside of our own self and our own moment of time? As Christians, we are called, first and foremost, to belittle Christ wherever we go. To get outside of our bubble of who we are and live the greater reality of who God has made us to be. Hence why this last part of connecting, I want to reread all of Romans 12. It's very short, as we remember from last week. But I want to move forward and ask the questions of, what are the obstacles in our life to keep us from connecting with others? Because we know that we're supposed to, as our mission statement is, connecting with God and with one another. So what are the things that might be limiting us and inhibiting us from getting outside of our own self and our own moment from doing that? So Romans 12 goes as follows. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all others. We all have different gifts, according to the grace given to each of you. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, then lead diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear brothers, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. There's a lot in that passage that is just wonderful. I don't know if it stood out to you, but there's a lot of commands in that passage. And obviously each command could be an entire meditation to meditate upon. But this chapter is a working out of Paul thinking through what salvation is, what redemption is, what it means to be someone who's a sinner, grabbed out of their sin, and placed into the kingdom of God, living out that new identity in Jesus. And it works out from there to then chapters 13, 14, and 15, having these discussions and debates about how to actually live rightly and well inside of your current situation in your current community. And it's an outgrowth of the reality that when you follow Jesus, you have a new command, a new focus, a new shift in life. Think about it. We all experience, even as Christians, an innate desire for our own self to get what we want, right? To get what we feel like we deserve. To get even. In the end, this revenge part in the last couple verses. But we ask the question, why is it that we as Christians don't believe that we should seek our own selfish gain or our own means? And that's what this passage addresses. I'm going to glean a little bit from a few of these verses, but I want you to ask yourself the question as I'm reading these. As a Christian, when I move forward in life, what are the obstacles that keep me from loving the Lord with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and loving my neighbor as myself? What are the obstacles that are there? Have that be a question reverberating in your mind right now. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. I'm going to offer that one of the first obstacles to serving the Lord wholeheartedly is an improper view of our own bodies and our own life. And this improper view has so many levels of pain that it goes with it. We are not given our own bodies and our own lives in order that we can just do whatever we want and seek our own gain. And I want to word this carefully, though, because in being a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, we're giving up our life. We're admitting that it's not ours, that our own will, our own desires, our own ways, they're not right. But I don't want us to have the view that God created us to live in misery. Some people have the wrong view that in order to have a life of sacrifice, it means that anything that we enjoy has to automatically be bad. Because sacrifice means death and holy and pleasing. So how do I make sure that I'm living a holy life pleasing to God? Well, I just have to give up anything fun. I think whenever people do this, they're missing the point of the passage. We like to generalize, I find often, because it's easier to handle generality than the complexity of life. So either, you know, you do whatever you want and you live life to the fullest, or anything that's good, you try to get rid of it. In our current world, there's a lot of debates of what is the true self? What is the mind? What is the body? What is the soul? And there's debates and there's arguments. And we allow some of those to creep into our Christian life where we maybe say what all that matters is what we do. Or maybe we say all that matters is so much what you believe, not so much what you do. And I want to say as Christians, that's not good. We have to live inside of the muddy complexity of this world. And that first and foremost starts off with asking, Lord, what do I have in my life that needs to be offered to you? Now, I know it was everybody's favorite sermon series, but who remembers the series on Leviticus? I know you're having flashbacks, PTSD, you know, like, oh no, he's going to talk about the ooey gooey chapters again. Please, Ben, never open to Leviticus. Well, let's go to Numbers. What we often miss when we talk about sacrifices is the reality is that whenever a bull or a lamb was sacrificed, that meat wasn't just burned all the way to cinders on the altar. It was that family giving that animal, and that animal then having some parts which were completely burned, but other parts were essentially cooked and given out and redistributed to the people, primarily to the priests, and then back to the family. And oftentimes, I don't know if you guys have noticed this in the times that you force yourself through the read-through, and you force yourself through the Pentateuch, and you force yourself through the first five. Oftentimes, the biggest times of sacrifice were the times of the festivals. How do you think the food from the festivals was made? It was the sacrifice. So when we think about what it means to be a living sacrifice, I think instead of thinking, what do I give up and no longer have any fun from? We need to ask ourselves, what do I have that whenever I present it to God can actually be a blessing to everyone? And that's where it becomes this second part of do not conform to the pattern of the world. The world says, use what you have to the best of your ability to get what you have for you. Get yours. But rather, this says, don't be conformed, but be transformed. Then you're able to test and approve what God's will is. Have you ever noticed that it's a whole lot easier to be friends with people who aren't trying to use you, but who just want to be with you and accept you for you? This is part of the transforming and renewing of our minds. Whenever we have our minds renewed by God, we view other people not by what we can use of them and get from them, but instead, how can I bless them? I can also point out, have you ever noticed that some of the most fun people to be around are the people who are always trying to help you get better? I mean, usually everyone's favorite teacher in high school is, you know, the one that pushes you. But if you have to go between the one that pushes you and the one that also has candy and pushes you, you're going to like the one who gives you candy, right? Or was I the only one who always tried to get free candy wherever they went growing up because my parents never gave me any? Scar, again, from my childhood. Hence why my dad was this size when he was in college. But this moves forward into this connecting. If we want to take the love of God and give it to others, there needs to be this reality that we have to have a renewed view of ourselves and a better view of ourselves, one that is inspired by God Himself. And this is very difficult as Christians because we know that we have to be humble. And we know, though, like it says here, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment. Notice what this doesn't say. This doesn't say think of yourself lower than you ought. The conversation of humility is one that is very big. It's very dynamic, and we have to be very careful. We live in a culture that celebrates pride, but kicks people who have it. For an example, a little social experiment. Who is the most tragic figure in all of Disney history? Who's the most tragic person? Like one person that you watch the Disney... Sorry, I have little daughters. When you watch a Disney movie, that you just cry because you think they're tragic. I think Gaston is a tragic figure. Now, Randy's curious about this.
How about Snoop or Dopey or...
Oh, no, they're just sad. There's a difference between sad and tragedy. There's very miserable characters, don't get me wrong. Gaston achieved everything that everyone told him he was supposed to. But when you watch that movie, you're told that you need to cheer against him. And that he's the true beast of the movie. Because he is so prideful. This is where he didn't think of himself with sober judgment. And we oftentimes think, well, I can't be prideful like a Gaston, so then if I'm good at something, I really can't let people know, because that's bragging if people know I'm good at something. Now let's pause and think about that for a moment. Right after Paul says you need to think about yourself with sober judgment, what does he go on and talk about? What gifts do you have that you need to use full to their potential, like every bit as much as you can? He doesn't say, if you're really good at something, make sure people don't realize it. No. One of our biggest inhibitors or one of the biggest blockers of connecting with people is we don't actually, I think, know who we are or let people know who we are because we were confused or scared about how we can be perceived. Now, it's hard to talk about the battle of, you know, well, I don't care what people think of me. Yes and no. Like, we all really want to make sure that people don't think bad of us. But I think we forget that if you have something, whether it be a skill, a talent, a blessing, that's something that can be used sacrificially for others in a good way. So, you know how there's that joke about like kids arguing like, no, my dad's the best at this to another kid in school. No, my dad could this. No, my dad could. Think about what it'd be like if we inside of our church bragged about what everybody was good at. And it didn't have to be this secret that someone was good at something. Like, it's not a secret that if you want to fix your boiler in your house, that you don't call me. Unless you want someone to carry the buckets of water out. If you want someone to soup up your super awesome, bright red 1979 super sweet truck, you say, hey, Ben, get me a phone book. You don't ask me to do anything. You know, maybe say, hold the oil pan while it drips out. But you shouldn't hold an oil pan. I know that much about mechanic stuff. You set it on the ground. But how many of us are willing to tell people, hey, I can do that? If we as a church want to, and this is, I'm not trying to use you, but think about this. If we want to be our full potential as a church, should we have four of us sitting in a room trying to figure out what should happen? Or should we have us as a congregation saying, hey, this is what I'm good at. This is what we're good at. These are our skills and talents and abilities. Let's use this for others around us. You know, the best coach in the world usually has other people that they consult. If you were to talk about the best football coach, he doesn't have zero assistant coaches. He's got 17 assistant coaches walking him through each decision, saying this is this, because the wide receiver coach knows the wide receivers better than the head coach. So he says, no, this person should do this. So as a church, as a congregation, the CLC, if you want us to really bless this church, let us know what you're good at. And don't be afraid to say, hey, here's an idea of something we can do. If we're not doing something already, is it really going to hurt to have us say, I don't think that that can happen? What instead is going on is I think we inside this church are as blessed as we can. We are filled to the brim with potential, and we're just waiting to have the honest conversation of how can we connect with each other well and use it. Because it's inside of those moments that we view each other better. We're able to maybe critique someone's idea for the better. There's something that there's a theory that an idea from conception all the way to production, let's just say the iPhone, has like seven different steps. There's the conception of it, there's the crafting of the actual material, there's the recrafting to make sure it's better, and then there's the branding, and then there's the actual marketing of it. There's all these, and I'm sure there's two more. But think about this. You might be someone who's really good at ideas. God blessed you with just a mind that puts out ideas all the time. But you have zero idea how to execute them. Or maybe you have zero resources to execute them. The world says, if you come up with an idea and people don't like it, then you're not worth much. Or it shoots you down. Or it says, how about you try to think of just wait until you have a great idea. We can be conformed to the image of Christ, and inside of the church, this is where we're safe to actually have that discussion of ideas. I am full of ideas, and I'm very bad at having the fully crafted idea. But it's that harboring of conversation inside of a church that we need to have. You see, once we understand who we are and our gifts and everything else, there's also this placing of level ground, of sober judgment. We're able to actually look at each other and say, my gift is the same value as your gift. So we're able to contribute just as much. There's this taking away where I'm going to say the biggest obstacle of connection, and that's so we often don't know our own gifts and abilities. Very few of us have been actually funneled and trained and coached into knowing who we are and what we can do. But then oftentimes, we're too proud to connect with others. And this goes back to the viewing people as, what can I get from them? So why would I connect with someone that I can't get a blessing from? And this is something that, I'll be honest, I battle with this. I struggle with this. I don't like calling whenever I know that it's going to be a draining conversation. I don't like the one-way conversations where it's like, yep, that person just leached my energy for 10 minutes. But think about this. Is that a sober judgment statement that I just made, or is that a statement of pride? See, inside of the church, we're not conformed to the pattern of this world that says power, influence, attractiveness, money, that those are the important things. Inside of the church, we say, this person's made in the image of God. 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 This person's gifted by 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 God. We don't practice the doctrines of God rightly if we try to say, this person's better, this person's worse. This third person's valuable, this person's not valuable. And this is where I want to challenge us. Are we, as Grace Bible Church, doing our job of rightly connecting with others because they're worth it, because they're people bearing the image of God? Or are we often not connecting with people because we don't think that they're going to be great? It's an open secret inside of churches that we like to have the best people come here. Like, I've heard conversations of, ooh, that person would really help us if they left that church and came here. I mean, like, all of us have probably heard some sort of weird distortion of that statement. But think about this. Wouldn't it be so much better if all of us instead were focusing on how can we get the most for our own self? Had the idea that God is so big, he's so great, he's so worthy of love, that any gift is valuable, and every person is valuable, and if they're using that gift where God's called them to use it, then that's the best possible situation, even if it isn't for us. I was listening to a podcast of Nathan Martin, who is one of the fastest marathoners in America. He also was a grade behind me in school and went to a rival high school in the county. He recalls this moment during a race where an opposing team's coach said to him, "Man, I wish you were on my team." Which, I mean, he was incredibly fast. Incredibly fast. This guy could run 5 kilometers, so 3.1 miles, in 15 minutes as a senior in high school. He was lightning fast. He ran a 1600 in 4:14. Like most of us, like that's three realms outside of just, we know that's fast, but that's insanely fast. He said on this podcast that that was one of the most sad things he ever heard, because he loved that his coach cared about every member on his team, even if it was Nathan Martin or the kid who was running a 30-minute. You see, Nathan Martin realized that if you want to be the best coach, you don't say, I want this, that, and the other. You say, these are my kids, and I love them. So if we want to be our best church, do you know what we first and foremost need to say? You're here, and I love you. And then we build from that. We build from the reality that every single person, it's great. And if someone finds a church home in Arkansas or Tennessee, we celebrate them, we love them, we worship them. The big obstacles to connecting. I have this book that I read on why are so many people leaving churches but aren't done with God. So in essence, they're connected with God, but they don't want to be connected with a church. So a question of connecting. I thought it was a very, very interesting book. And inside of it had these 4 points of what people wanted, but what they instead received inside of the doors of a church. Now, obviously, this is a 160-page book written by sociologists who have their surveys. And the guy who wrote this book doesn't want people to leave the church. So I want to put that out there. But he said, the reason why a lot of people leave church, pay attention to this, they want community, but instead they receive judgment. They wanted to affect the life of the church, but instead got bureaucracy. They wanted conversation, but instead got doctrine. And they wanted meaningful engagement with the world, but instead got moral prescription. Now, each of those taken as an individual item, we can wrestle and we can pull, and there's nothing wrong with saying something's wrong. There's nothing wrong with saying, hey, that shouldn't happen with the bureaucracy. There's a reason why we have order. And there's nothing wrong with doctrine saying, this is what the Bible says. And there's nothing wrong with saying, live this way or don't live this way. But what happens often inside of a church is instead of being a community where we allow the real life conversations to happen here with each other, churches so often become a machine that either you fit or you get spit out, you get chewed up, you're just done. People don't have the right gift for the right task. Or they have an actual question and they're wrestling through it, but they talk to it with someone who wrestled through it a long time ago. So instead of getting a conversation, they get an answer. The obstacles to having connection with others is often simpler than we think. The memory verse for Children's Church is, you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. It's found in, I think, every single one of the Gospels. But do you know what we often fall short of inside of that? And this is the big obstacle, and it summarizes a lot. We don't love others as ourselves. And that's hard, because that's the battle of life. We're always, always, always trying to grow. We're trying to get better. We're trying to do the Lord's will better. But I want to encourage you. Connect with God, asking Him what His will is, and then just be sympathetic towards others. Have action. Have care. All of us, I mean, I've often had that moment where I don't so much want the answer to the question I already know what the answer is. I just want to know that there's other people who wrestle with the same question as my own self. Can anybody else sympathize with that? We all know the right or wrong, but we want to know, can someone else just agree they're also frustrated at this? These steps of community, these steps of connection. At Grace Bible Church, we're about connecting with God and with one another. And it's that connection with God that feeds our connections with others. But we need to be about that connecting with others a lot. We need to be about it in a humble way, a loving way. And this is going to sound terrible, but we meet people on their terms, not our own. I don't ask each of you to go out for an hour run with me in order to have our conversation. Think about just that statement. How often do we expect someone else to meet us on our term and then get frustrated that they're not connected with us? I'm so guilty of that all the time. But that's the beauty of the church. When it says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be renewed. This isn't a one-time you're stamped inside of the press, inside of the factory. This is every single moment of the day we have the opportunity to be deprogrammed from the way of the world and reprogrammed to the way of God. We're not the old dog who can't learn new tricks. We're the people who are indwelled by the Holy Spirit of the infinite, almighty Creator God. There's never a moment in your life that you're too late to be more like Jesus. There's never a moment in your life that God's like, eh, they're useless to me now. It's inside of those moments that we grow, we learn, and we connect. We're going to have a song. We're going to do communion and have a closing song. And while I pray and while we sing that song, I want you to meditate upon the fact that you are connected with God through Jesus Christ. And He, by that connection with God, you are able to have a transformed and renewed relationship with Him and others. So when you partake of the communion elements, You're only able to actually have communion with God because of Jesus. And that's the most important connection.